which is wireless technology, very much responsible for the networks that we were talking about earlier. Later, I started working in a film production place. I actually expanded my background as a painter, although I still consider myself a painter in my head. This is a movie that had a huge influence on me. Fritz Lang's Metropolis, some of you who saw it now. I just love this movie. I had this strange kind of luck of right after school, art school, going into Venice Biennale, getting really into the art world, and I realized I could see where my future was going to go. And it didn't sound very interesting at the gallery, but when I was in nightclubs, it was really interesting. So I dropped the working in the art world and went towards the gallery world and started a band in New York and was working with media. But really, it was an introduction to thinking about media. And I continued having a kind of a parallel world to science, most radically by getting married to a physicist and then going to Egypt to look at how to find hidden chambers at Cheops pyramids using cosmic rays. So one of the things I discovered living with the scientists and being surrounded is how eccentric they are, how much they're very much like artists, the good ones. And also how they talk matter-of-factly about some of the craziest things, like looking for hidden chambers and pyramids, using cosmic rays, which are right now bombarding us, right? So as we're speaking, cosmic rays are hitting us. This is, matter of fact, for scientists, to me, it's mind-blowing still to think that cosmic rays are actually hitting these spaces and that they come from galaxies and nebulas and from outer space. In fact, the biggest issue with cosmic rays to scientists is to think about how it may destroy the experiment. Anyway, so moving on, surrounded by people like Liz Seaborg and Murray Gell-Mann, who were the Nobel laureates, but also introduced me to thinking about creativity and science. In particular, Liz Seaborg, who discovered the elements of Morbian, announced it through a game show on the radio. So there's, I got introduced to how popular culture mixes with science, by being surrounded with scientists and how much science is really difficult to understand for a layman. And then most recently, 15 years ago, I worked with Stephen Hawking, which really introduced me to the idea of the cyborg, I should say, and the idea of consciousness and how important it is in relation to technologically mediated consciousness. Why is this important? Because it actually led me to thinking about pursuing a PhD and really trying to figure out ways where I could talk to humanists and scientists and people that working as an artist, well-trained teachers can do it. I wanted to contextualize and understand what it is I was doing, but also how. And through meeting Professor Porter's mother, I actually had access to his archives, and I got very interested in his philosophy, not so much in his architecture, as much as in the philosophy, and in particular, talking about the idea of ethics and integrity in working with forms, structures, collaboration, and he had a very close relationship with Page, which brought me back to thinking about sound and architectures and tensile systems. So this is one image of Bucky and Black Mountain College with Rauschenberg and many different artists who worked with him. There was a close relationship. Again, why is this important? Because as an engineer, he felt strongly that artists are trained as comprehensivists to look at the big picture. And this is so important for science that's trained to look So this image brought me to Mountain College, if you believe that. This is a dome of Montreal in 1967, a very famous dome that Bucky created. And it actually was helpful in deciphering the Dutch-Christopher ring, which is the third carbon molecule. So we have diamond graphite and Bucky balls. So the Bucky balls are actually kind of a symbol of Mantic. This is this new carbon element. But notice it's 1985, so it's almost 20 years later. But this was deciphered because long end protein did not have strong enough to really see the geometries of this molecule they just saw. And the molecule looks something like what you see to the right, to the left, sorry, and the right is how we are usually presented with models, scientific models, which are very static. They look almost plastic, and I really wanted to shift this. So when I met Gdansk, he started explaining to me how this scanning tunneling microscope works. And for the lay people in the audience, I'll just very quickly explain it the way he did to me 10 years ago, and how important actually it is to our paradigm shift in technology from thinking top down to actually thinking bottom up. So if you imagine this figure as a Eiffel Tower, which of course is impossible to imagine, moving along the golf ball, you're actually feeling the surface, and yet it's not solid and it's nothingness. So if you start thinking again as if I was listening to the scientists talk about cosmic rays. Oh, we're just being bombarded with cosmic rays every day. Same thing. Oh, it's just empty space. It's like you're moving through nothingness. So I felt like this is actually really, really significant that this figure that he was showing me is actually finally terminated by a simple atom. I find a lot of wonder in this, and I equate it to this being 21st century, this first being a kind of a way that the STM works in the beginning of the 20th century, and again, it's connected to sound. So we started playing together. I learned the amount of time, patience, and work that it has to go into shifting and moving molecules is absolutely stunning. So this is one of the experiments to understand how it works. And of course, the moment you place it, it feels they move around. So nothing is static. And this is a quote from him that Gdansk gave, again, explaining it to me, that we're actually looking at probabilities and waves. So it's mainly nothingness or empty space. And then this discussion brought us to relating this through Buddhism and Buddhistic ideas that talks about this. The first collaboration we did was to really rethink how Bucky balls work and our experience we talked about. So this is just an idea. So again, you're moving and shifting these molecules with your shadow, which was philosophically important to us because when you're working with nanotype, you're actually working at a distance. So to affect something from a distance is quite stunning. It's a very strange feeling, but that's what happens. And the larger the scale is, the better. So I didn't really want to do nano architectures using STM. I actually wanted to flip it and do something really huge. That brings me to moving towards the morph and sound. While we were working on the Bucky balls in the zero wave, he was with his group experimenting with sound. We'll talk more about it, but I'll just mention why it was inspiring to me and how artists and scientists working together can benefit from each other's experiences, which was brought up yesterday with Roger Stock in particular. When he came up with the vibrations of this surface that is a live yeast cell, They got the usual graphs, which were very exciting to them. He knew that this would not be exciting to me, and he was right, it wouldn't be. But Andrew, who was working on his team, was also a physician, which happens a lot in science. So kids said, "Is that, why don't you just amplify and accelerate and send her audio file?" And that's what they did. It really was exciting. So, this is the sound of a live cell.